belly full of beer. My old man's a drunker than a barrel full of monkeys, and my old lady, she don't care. My sister looks cute in her braces and boots, a handful of grease in her hair.
So much of my imagery at that time came from my childhood, you know. I mean, Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting is totally recalls, you know, my, so when I was like 14, 15, going to all these places in the north of England, like the Mecca's ballrooms and the Boston Gliderdromes, and that's what happened, you know, it was just too much beer and, you know, bang, you know, somebody would start a fight and it was all over the place. Steeped in the days of the Mods and the Rockers and all the sort of confrontations. It was just a straightforward Saturday night's all right for drinking, fighting, and getting screwed up. But then again, a lot of the power of that song comes from the chords. You know, I mean, it has one of the great strident, you know, blistering, you know, guitar chords and ever created. And you don't even have to wait for the lyrics to come in.
And it goes exactly like this, Eric. One, two, three, pop, pop, pop.
Performing in the States has always been a unique situation for Elton, but specifically the playing in Southern California, Los Angeles, and the Hollywood Bowl, other than the Beatles having played there, was really not a venue for rock and roll acts to play. But Elton certainly knew about the Hollywood Bowl, and it seemed the right place. It was all leading to it. It was Hollywood, it was Goodbye Yellow Brick Road.
Because it was the Hollywood Bowl, we'd never played the Hollywood before, and we wanted to do something a little bit more special. And I was introduced by Linda Lovelace, which was... and we had people like the Pope coming down and saying, now the Pope and the Queen or whatever it was. And then I came down with this huge straw, kind of looked like a cheesecake hat.
The gentleman you've all been waiting for, the biggest, most colossal, gigantic, fantastic Elton John.
It was kind of theatrical, that show. We had the pianos with E-L-T-O-N on them, with doves in them, that, but, you know, when they were supposed to fly out the pianos.
And I remember the doves wouldn't come out the piano. They didn't want to go, they were frightened to death.
I remember having to sit in one of the pianos throwing these doves out because they wouldn't go out.
We were playing stuff off Yellow Brick Road before the album was out. That was, you know, this was just part of the tour. We were giving those fans a little taste, you know, of stuff they'd never heard. And it never occurred to us not to do it, you know. Oh, save that back, lads. What, save it till the album comes out. It's like, big deal, you know.
Each song had its own specific identity. It wasn't just a love song, I miss you, I love you, and then the next one is, I love you, I miss you. You had Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting, Candle in the Wind, Benny and the Jets. I mean, completely different.
Benny and the Jets was probably, to us, the most uncommercial song we'd ever, you know, done. It was like, this is really odd. And then Gus worked his magic on it and turned it into a live-sounding track.
So basically, this is how it sounded when we came out of the studio, before we added any of the stuff to it later on. So it just sounds like any other regular studio recording. We put on some sound effects, which are basically from an Elton concert at the Festival Hall that he'd done about 4 or 5 years before. You've got Jimi Hendrix's applause from the Isle of Wight, which was running on a loop, which we just faded in whenever we wanted to. We threw a load of flatback on it to make it sound live, dubbed on some whistles and hand claps doing the wrong beat, because English audiences always do the wrong beat. They're always on the on instead of on the off, which drives me crazy, but that's what they do. There are the claps.
And the effects on.
And the effects on. And that's the T-boy doing a whistle. Well, it might be you, I don't know.
I think it was you.
It can't be me, because I can't do those whistles. It's a pathetic whistle, and I can't do them at all. Okay, put it all in again.
It was getting a lot of play on black radio at the time. There was a guy at Universal Records called Pat Piccolo, and I, for some reason, I always remember his name, probably because he was the one that was so gung-ho about releasing it.
To this day, I can't see Benny and the Jets being a hit, and I fought tooth and nail against it coming out from the Yellow Brick Road album.
He said, are you willing to put your career on a line or something like that? I said, well, not really, but I think we should release it as a single. I think you'll be an R&B artist as well as a pop artist. So he called the main office, and he told them what we should do with Benny and the Jets, and we did. We released it, and sure enough, it went to number one pop as well as number one R&B, which amazed the world, I think. It certainly amazed Elton.
Benny and the Jets.
Never in a million years, you know, being a white boy from Pinner, did I ever think I was going to have a black record in the charts? And then that was the first time I topped the R&B charts.
She's got electric boots. I know her soon. You know I read it in a magazine.
He was accepted at all the black stations, which was amazing. I mean, Elton John, English kid. It didn't happen. I think probably the only other person from England maybe was Dusty Springfield. She got accepted. But yeah, it was unusual.
At that point in time, my musical odyssey hadn't developed enough where I felt confident enough to dictate to him how I felt songs should sound. I gave them to him and kind of ran away.
Bernie would have a bunch of lyrics. And I would write to about 90% of his lyrics back then. There weren't that many lyrics discarded. This piece is before the drugs set in and the bad things started happening to us. This is, you know, this is at a time when all the good things were happening to us, so it was...
Bernie loved the idea of setting up little pictures in your mind. It never mattered to him, necessarily, that the lyric told a story from front to back. What mattered to him was setting up little cameo, little visual pictures in your mind. And if they didn't link together, well, so what? You know, the important thing is, does it sound good when it's sung? Does it roll off the tongue well?
I'm back on dry land once again. Opportunity awaits me like a rat in a drain. We're all hunting honey with money to burn. Just a short time to show you the tricks that we've learned.
We were just more interested in creating very visual pieces of work that went beyond what people imagined the pop song of that time to be. I don't know, maybe in retrospect it is subconsciously is a concept album, because you're just presenting all these characters in this sort of cinematic framework, you know. You're bringing up Danny Bailey and Sweet Painted Ladies and Dirty Little Girls, and, you know, they're all part of this big sort of complex movie.
Oh, Sweet Painted Ladies, guess it's always been the same. Getting paid for being late, guess that's the name of the game. Oh, sweet painted ladies, guess it's always been the same. Getting paid for being late, guess that's the name of the game. Oh, yeah.
I think
think by the time he came to record Yellow Brick Road, he had really found himself as a musician and as a singer, and had discovered that his voice was one of the most versatile sort of rock voices that we'd heard, because he could sing flat out slam bam rock, and he could also sing ballads that were almost show tunes, and he could do it without any sense of forcing it or parodying the styles involved.
I think I'd found my own little niche band. I didn't have to copy anybody. I was finding my feet as a vocalist, because I never started off as a vocalist. I started off as a piano player. It was told that because his songs weren't being recorded by someone else, he'd have to record his own songs. And it's like, oh my God, I've got to sing, have I? So I've gotten as a much better singer over the years, and my voice has changed. But by that time, I think I was finding my own style.
Sometimes you dream, and sometimes it seems there's nothing there at all. You just seem older than yesterday, and you're waiting for tomorrow to call. You draw to the curtains, and one thing's for certain, you're cozy in your little room.
Maybe we should solo it right there.
Yeah, it comes in just before the chorus properly, I think.
Okay. Here he comes.
Let's go shoot a hole in the moon. Oh, and Roy Rogers is riding tonight.
Just love the pronunciation of Rogers.
Returning to our silver screens.
It's interesting because when you think of the big vocal spreads that are on some of the tracks that I worked on, I noticed that in that one, Elton only accompanied himself, singing a line slightly ahead, you know, a harmony with himself, which really personalised it. It made it zoom into just, you could imagine Roy Rogers the cowboy, or Elton John the cowboy.
And hold my rain.